Hello, welcome to everyone. Welcome to our Pulse program, Witness to Education in Afghanistan and Throughout the World. My name is Ali, and I'm here with Global Nomads Group in New York City in the United States. We're so happy to host this program and to welcome schools from around the US and beyond. Today in our Pulse program, we're going to focus on the situation of education in Afghanistan, as well as in your communities around the world. And together, we're going to try to answer this question of how can we, as young people, use education to create positive change in our communities. So this forum, this live broadcast, you can think of it like a virtual town hall discussion. We have live participants at several schools, our marvelous guest speaker, Mellissa Fung, and a live audience. And if you're watching, please feel free to chat in questions on the chat box, which is to the right of the broadcast screen. So to get started, I'm going to ask each school to briefly introduce themselves, having one student sharing their name, the name of your school, and where you're located in the world, and an interesting thing that you learned about education in Afghanistan through the curriculum activities that prepared you for this broadcast. So why don't we start with Lynn Bloom, then we'll go to School of Education and Training, and then to Belmont. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Larisha. I go to Lynn Bloom in the United States of America. It's in Chicago, Illinois. Something that I learned about Afghanistan, about how people do things in Afghanistan, is that religion is very traditional, and it means a lot. And here at our school, me along with my peers are some of the ninth grade students at Lynn Bloom. Our school specializes in math and science, and we have a very diverse group of people here. Accompanying us is our human geography teachers, Mrs. Myers and Mr. Brannigan. You guys are welcome to ask us questions about our lives and similarities and differences. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Larisha. Let's go to School of Education and Training.
Thank you. Hello, my name is Christian Reynoso. I come from the School of Education and Training from Paterson, New Jersey. One thing I learned from this whole thing is that, I heard that girls had to dress themselves, had to disguise themselves as guys to get an education. I was wondering if that was true or not. Thank you.
Great, thank you. A good question, and we can get to that in a moment. Let's go to Belmont. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Maggie, and we are from Belmont High School, right outside of Boston, Massachusetts, on the East Coast. And we're a class of leadership consisting of different 11th and 12th school. We have an interest in how education has improved in the country of Afghanistan with different power shifts with the Taliban. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Maggie. Already we're seeing that education has so much more to do than actually what happens in school. It has to do with culture and religion, as well as clothing and gender and change throughout time. And one of the people who's going to help us try to understand this complex topic a bit more and relate it to our own communities is our wonderful guest speaker. Her name is Mellissa Fung, and I'll turn it over to her in a moment, but I just want to give a little bit of background. So Mellissa is a celebrated and award-winning journalist, former CBC correspondent. She has reported on world affairs for the past 20 years, and in the past few years, focused on issues within Afghanistan, going back and forth to the country. Her reporting has focused on education as well as other topics. She's covered the war in Afghanistan and produced award-winning documentaries such as Canada's Ugly Secret, No Country for Horses. And she's been featured as a keynote speaker for a number of amazing organizations, including the Pulitzer Center for Crisis Reporting, which is sponsoring this broadcast with us. So thanks to them. And I want to turn it over to Mellissa to share a bit more about her work. And particularly, Mellissa, what has been the focus of your reporting in Afghanistan, particularly in regards to education, and what have you learned over the past few years? Thank you.
Thanks, Ali. Hi, everybody. The last few years has been really interesting because as the military mission winds down in Afghanistan, I think it's really important to look at some of the progress that's been made. And one of those areas where there has been a lot of progress is in education. And so part of my interest in exploring this topic in more depth is to find out whether it is sustainable after all the foreign troops leave next year. And so I've been going, as Ali said, back and forth the last couple years to visit schools, talk to teachers, talk to students about what their feelings are in terms of the future of education in that country. And so that's been my focus the last couple years. In terms of what I've learned, there's still a lot of challenges remaining. There's been great progress over the last 10 to 12 years. You talk about the fact that there were no girls in school 12 years ago, and mostly boys were being educated. Today, there's, almost 10 million kids in school, and 40% of them are girls, and that's huge progress. But there are still lots of challenges, and those are some of the things I hope we'll get into a little bit more in depth over the course of this discussion.
Thanks, Mellissa. And you started to talk a little bit about the history during the Taliban regime. It was not possible for many girls to be educated. But before that, what was the case? Could you share a little bit how the situation of education in the country has changed over the past few decades before the Taliban and now after?
I think it's really important. That's a good question, to look at it in a wider context. It's not that girls have never been able to go to school in Afghanistan, and sometimes we forget about that when we're talking about the Taliban years. But between the 1930s and the 1970s, Afghanistan was ruled by King Zahir Shah, and he had made primary schools available to most, about half the population in the country, mostly in the cities. It's always harder when you're talking about the rural parts of the country. King Shah also expanded the secondary school system and opened Kabul University. Between the 1970s and the 1980s, the People's Democratic Party of Afghanistan ruled the country, and they totally reformed the education system as well. Men were as equally educated as women. Girls were going to school with boys. And then in 1979, the Soviets invaded Afghanistan, and that's when the system slowly started to be eroded. Successive wars meant that teachers were fleeing to neighboring countries. It only got worse under the Taliban when they took over in 1996. They banned women from going to school. Women were not even allowed to go outside without a male chaperone or having a man's permission to leave the house. There were about a million kids in school during the time of the Taliban. Almost all of them were boys and going to schools in madrasas, which are religious schools. No girls allowed. And when the Taliban were finally overthrown in 2001, the process of rebuilding the education system really began, and it became a focus of international donors and the international community. Kabul University, which was shut down by the Taliban, was reopened. I think that was in 2002. And other universities were built around the country, Kandahar University, Nagarhar University. So in all across the country, schools were being rebuilt, universities were being rebuilt. And in fact, the American University in Kabul opened in 2006. There's still lots of problems, as I was saying, you know, in terms of infrastructure. A lot of schools had to really be rebuilt from the ground up. But, you know, there are now, I think, between 2001 to now, 5,000 new school buildings had been built. You see, in the rural communities, a lot of kids still going to school outside because they don't have a school building. And slowly, you know, the process of rebuilding and development is being spread out across the country to the provinces. So in a nutshell, that's, you know, the last few decades. It's a lot to cover, Ali. It's a big question.
It is a big question, and thank you for that wonderful summary. It is a lot of history and a lot of change in that time. And as you said, I think it's really important for all of us to have some context. You know, girls have gone to school in Afghanistan and went to school for many years quite successfully before the Taliban, and it's important to know that, but the media doesn't always show all sides of the story. And so the last question that I want to pose to you before we turn it over to our eager students is about this issue of images and media, building on what you've talked about. So in the media in the United States and Canada and other parts of the world, a lot of the images that are shown of Afghanistan are negative. They are of the war or of girls not being educated during the Taliban, even though that's no longer the situation necessarily. So in your experience and in your time in Afghanistan, how do these images that we see in the media reflect the reality or not reflect the reality of what's going on in different parts of the country? Thank you.
I think it's important to remember that, you know, when you're covering a war, and, you know, in a lot of ways, the war is over in Afghanistan right now. The last few weeks have been really difficult because there have been a lot of suicide attacks. The Taliban have really stepped it up the last few weeks, leading up to this big donor conference that was held in London last week. And so those images are, you know, what, as a journalist, it's frustrating because that's what makes news, right? That's what you're going to see in terms of news coverage. But when you're gauging the progress of a country, that's only one side of the story, and you have to look at other things, not just what the Taliban are doing. And so education is one area where there has been great progress. Healthcare is another area where there's been great progress. You know, 20 years ago, Afghanistan's, not even 20 years, 15 years ago, Afghanistan's maternal mortality rate was the highest in the world. You know, one out of every 12 women died giving birth. That's huge compared to what we see in this country. That rate has fallen. It's now one in 50 women, which is still very high, nowhere close to what a developed country would be like, but that's still progress. You know, 80% of Afghans are now within 2 hours of a health facility. The maternal, the child and infant mortality rates have also been falling. So there's been a lot of progress, and that's often not reported, or if it is, it gets lost in the images of suicide bombings and the aftermath of, you know, Taliban attacks. And I think it's important to give context to what is really going on there. There has been great progress in the last 12 years. And what Afghans tell me all the time now is that they're worried about what's going to happen to that progress, you know, when all the foreign troops leave next year. So that's where we are in a nutshell. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Mellissa. That's incredible insight for us to have. And I did just also want to share with everyone watching in regards to the recent insecurity, the attacks in Kabul, that is one reason why we don't have our group of Afghan students participating right now. The situation is just a little tenuous there, and people are continuing with their daily lives, but still weren't able to meet this late in the evening. Mellissa is a great resource, and now is the time when we can really dive deeper into all this material that she's been sharing. For those of you who are joining online, thank you for your questions. Theodore, we'll get to yours in just a few minutes. And for those of you watching, please keep chatting in questions for Mellissa, and as well as for our three schools connecting. Now I'm going to turn it over to you, students, to ask questions of Mellissa and each other. We'll use the first half of this discussion to delve deeper into education within Afghanistan, and at the end of the broadcast, we'll talk more about what we can learn from these lessons and apply to our own communities. So we'll kind of go round robin around our virtual room with questions. And as a reminder, please share your name and a little bit of context for your question before you ask it. Either what are things like in your community, or why are you wondering this? What do you want to know? And why don't we start with a question from the School of Education and Training. Then we'll go to Belmont and Lindblom. You don't need to wait for me to cut in. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Precious. I'm from the School of Education and Training, and my question would be for Mellissa. Will she open a school for girls in Afghanistan?
Got it. Cut out a little bit. Sorry, Precious, can you ask that question again? I missed it. I think you were cutting out. I don't know if it was my connection.
Would you open a school for girls in Afghanistan?
Would I open a school?
Yes.
I do not have the resources to open a school. There are lots of schools that are already doing really well in Afghanistan, and I think, you know, what my role mostly is to share some of those stories, and I'll share one now, and it's not just a girls' school. I visited the Marifat school when I was in Afghanistan last month, and it is a pretty big school in an ethnic Hazara neighborhood of Kabul. It is co-ed, which is really interesting because the founder of that school, Aziz Royesh, is a really neat guy. He has a neat history. He did not finish school himself because his family had to flee to Pakistan when the Taliban took over, or when the Soviets invaded. But in Pakistan, he started a school called the Marifat School, and he really believed in the principles of universal education, teaching things like human rights, democracy, that kind of thing. And the school did so well that when the Taliban fell, he decided to move that school back to their hometown of Kabul. And now there are over 1,000 kids in that school, girls and boys, and he really believed that girls and boys should go to school together, because what it does, it creates a really good atmosphere of harmony, not only within the school, but within the wider community. And so he decided that, you know, he was going to have co-ed classes, which was really not done in Afghanistan. He ran into some trouble with the local government, the Afghan government, which is not really too happy with the way he was doing things. First of all, he was teaching things like social studies and democracy, and he had girls and boys in the same class. So they said, if you don't separate the girls from the boys, your graduates won't be allowed to write the university entrance exam, so that your graduates therefore won't be able to go to our state-run universities after they graduate from your school. So reluctantly, Aziz in 2006 separated the girls from the boys, and so now there's a girls' building and a boys' building. But when I went to visit last month, I noticed in a kindergarten class that it was co-ed again. It was girls and boys. And I said, I thought you had to separate the classes. And he said, well, you know, the older grades are still separated, but last year I put kindergarten back together. And this year I put grade one back together. And I said, what about next year? He goes, I don't know, maybe, you know, grade two is going to be co-ed again. So he's slowly pushing back against the system because he really does believe that classes should be co-ed like yours. You know, I'm seeing you're not just a girls' school, right? So that's his philosophy anyway. But to go back to your original question, I don't know anything about, you know, I don't know enough about education and the system there to think that I can go and open a school. What's important is that I support programs and do stories on programs that support Afghans, to further their own education. So, for example, I support a charity in Canada, an NGO, which helps train Afghan teachers. And so in that way, you know, education is sustainable because you're training Afghans to take it over themselves. You're not relying on foreign donors to come in and take over the system. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mellissa. And before we go to Belmont, I just wanted to share something that Mellissa and I had talked about was one of the reasons that she's so excited about the Marifat School is because it's entirely Afghan-supported and Afghan-run, and there's no one coming in from the outside and deciding what the curriculum or what the structure should be. So that gets back to what you brought up earlier, Mellissa, of your question of sustainability and how can people continue this progress. Let's go to Belmont and then Lynn Bloom. Thank you. Belmont, it seems like we cannot see you. I'm not sure if you dropped. So we're going to go to Lynn Bloom for a question, and then we'll come back to Belmont. Thank you.
Oh, sorry.
Hey, I'm from Lynn Bloom Math and Science Academy in Chicago, Illinois, and I have a question for the journalist about the future for Afghanistan. So, when Afghanistan reaches a state like America, where education is in a stable condition, do you think that education or schools individually should be funded by the state or the government, or should they have their own means of funding? So, like, do you think that Afghanistan should continue to fund the schools when they become like America, or should the schools support themselves?
I think it's a good question you're asking. I think what is important to understand is that the education system in Afghanistan right now is very similar to what we have here in the United States and in Canada. There are state-funded schools, public schools, and there are also private schools, which are funded by the community. The Marifat School is actually a private school. There's a tuition fee for each student. It's not, you know, it's not as expensive as private schools are in this country, but it's still considered a private school. There are public schools that are funded solely by the government, and you know, and that's it'll be interesting to see how Afghans decide to take their education system or where they decide to take it going forward, because you know the government is broke. There is not a lot of money, and they keep asking international donors for help. And so, you know, what I hear from educators in Afghanistan I had spoken to the last education minister in Kabul, was that, you know, perhaps the international community can support us not solely through donations of money, but maybe we can strike up partnerships with schools in America or in Canada. Maybe there can be some exchange programs where some of our students can travel to North America and study for a while and have some maybe teachers from the US and Canada go to Afghanistan for a while and do exchanges that way. And so I think, you know, they still know that they have a lot to learn from us. But their system right now is, I think it's built on pretty, being rebuilt on pretty solid ground. And I think it'll be interesting to see where Afghans decide to take it going forward. Thanks.
Thank you. That's a great question, a lot to think about. Belmont, do we have you back? If so, please unmute and ask a question. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lizzie. So the first part of my question is for Mellissa, and the second part kind of opens it up to the rest of the schools. I was wondering, in Afghanistan, if, like, what people are doing after school, like, are most people going to college or entering straight into the workforce, or what are they doing? And also, same question for the other schools in America. Thank you.
I missed the second part of that question, but I'll answer the first part first. It's a really good question. You know, after high school, a lot of people are going to colleges and universities, but I think what you're getting at is, are there jobs for them after? And that is one of the main issues, one of the main challenges facing Afghanistan right now. It is, the economy is very bad. Unemployment, I think, is at, don't quote me, but I think it's really, really high. I'm not going to give a percent because I think the number that I'm thinking might be too high, but it's a huge problem. There are, you know, the new government, the new president, Ghani, he knows that the number one priority is going to be getting the economy going and creating jobs for all these people coming out of school. Right now, it's a huge problem in terms of finding work for all these now newly educated Afghans. So, you know, the thing that people were telling me on this last trip was that, again, this is where the international community can, again, try to help Afghanistan rebuild its economy. You know, the resource sector is a huge, has huge potential. Afghanistan has huge natural resources, and, you know, they're not so much looking for, again, money, but they're looking for our expertise. So, you know, especially as a Canadian, you know, our mining sector, our mining companies have, there's you know, decades of expertise, and they're saying that maybe, you know, there can, again, build some partnerships between North American companies and Afghan companies trying to tap into their resource sector to help create jobs. And so that's it's a really good question, that because the economy is so bad right now and security is still clearly a problem, finding jobs for all these newly educated people, it's one of the main challenges for this new government. Thanks.
Thank you, Mellissa. And Lizzie, I love your question, and I love that you turned it to the other schools participating. So let's have them answer in just a moment. Also, one of our online viewers, Nahid, who is an executive administrator at the Zabuli Education Center in Daysabs, which is just outside of Kabul. She's a marvelous educator and a friend of GNG's. She also wants to know about education in different parts of the world, and what is the norm for education? What do people do after they finish high school, like Lizzie's question? So let's go first to School of Education and Training, and then we'll go to Lynn Bloom. What do people do after high school in your community? Are there any of the same problems that Mellissa was discussing?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Education. Excuse me, can you repeat that again? I'm so sorry.
Do you need me to repeat?
Yes, please.
Okay. So both Lizzie and one of our online viewers, Nahid, who's a teacher just outside of Kabul, want to know what is education like in your community? What do people do after high school? Do people go to college? Do they get jobs? Are you facing any of the problems that Mellissa talked about? Thank you.
Well, over here, some girls in our college, you know, some pursue careers, because over here, it's kind of tough. It's kind of hard to go pursue a career because it's hard to get employed. Because, like, around here, this is really difficult. That's all I can say, really.
I like to add that, you know, in Paterson, New Jersey, period, after you finish college, a lot of people, they can go out of state or they can stay in state and go to college or trade school, but even after that, it's hard to find employment. So we do face some of the problems that people are seeing in Afghanistan in terms of looking for a job, because the job market is increasingly difficult as the years go by. Thank you.
Thank you, my friends. Let's go to Lynn Bloom. Same questions for you.
Sorry.
Okay. Hi, I'm Larisha again from Lynn Bloom. I just think in our community now, like where I live, it's kind of difficult for people to get scholarships to go to college. So if you can't get a scholarship, then how could you go? It's not that they don't want to go, because it's always those couple of people who are a bad bunch, but not everyone, you know, contributes to that. But like at this school, I think it's like a great amount of people who are interested and have the potential to go to college and the motivation. But here the economy is not as good as it can be. So I think that's a problem and difficulty as well. Thank you.
Thank you. So what I'm hearing from a lot of you is people have the motivation and to go to college or to get jobs and maybe the tools, but not the resources that they need, or the jobs just aren't available. That's something we definitely have in common. I have two questions from our online audience, and then we'll take another round from our schools participating live. So questions for you, Mellissa, briefly. Our friend Theodore, who I think is in Pendleton, South Carolina, wants to know if you can comment on the accessibility for children with disabilities. Do they have access to education? Has there been progress in this area? And going back to our discussion of jobs, Maya wants to know what percentage of women have jobs in Afghanistan. I'm not sure how specifically you can speak to either, but any info would be helpful. Thank you.
In terms of accessibility, that it's a really good question. I don't have numbers on it, but I know that it's a challenge, and especially in outside of the main cities. So Kabul is like it's a little different from the rest of the country, obviously, because it is the center, it is the capital. Once you get out into the villages and the more rural places, it's a problem. There is a huge sort of urban-rural divide in Afghanistan when it comes to not only education, but it gets worse when you talk about accessibility and kids with disabilities. But I do know that there are special programs. I visited a program a few years ago for kids who were blind, and there was a special school for them, and that was internationally funded. So it'll be interesting. You know, I haven't revisited that school, but it'd be interesting to see what happens after if the pullout leads to their donors, you know, maybe wanting to take it into a different direction. The second question, I'm sorry, Ali, can you repeat again?
Yes, what percentage of women?
I don't have an exact number, but it is very low opportunities for women. The number of women who are unemployed is really high, and I think, you know, a lot of that goes back to the Taliban years, right? You had a whole generation of women who were not educated, not able to even leave the house without a male chaperone, basically, you know, forced to stay at home. And what's been really interesting over the last 12 years is that some of those women who were not allowed to go to school as little girls are now learning literacy, attending literacy programs in Afghanistan. There have been more than 250,000 women who are now literate, who were not allowed to go to school as girls. I'll give the example of at the Marifat School, Aziz, the founder I was telling you about, his own sister was not allowed to go to school as a little girl. And she was, when the family fled to Pakistan, she was married off at the age of 14 to an older man. And the story gets worse because the older man eventually left her. And in Afghanistan, divorce is something that's very complicated and difficult for women. And so when her husband left, it sort of left her in limbo. And so until she could officially get a divorce that was recognized by the state, she couldn't really do anything. And it took 8 years for her to finally get this husband to divorce her. And, you know, by then she was 26 years old, and Aziz said, "What do you want to do with the rest of your life?" And she said, "I don't know. I don't know how to read. I don't know how to write." And he said, "Why don't you come to school? Come to my school." And so at the age of 26, she went to kindergarten with Aziz's own daughter. So the aunt and the daughter were going to school together. And you know, she finally learned how to read and write. She graduated from the Marifat School. She is now taking night school, and she's running the kindergarten program at the Marifat School. So she's an example of one of these women who didn't have opportunities when they were young. Employment prospects not good, but getting an education allowed her to get herself out of that situation. And so she's only one woman who managed to find her way out of her situation. But and there are, you know, there are millions of women in who find themselves, you know, uneducated. But now opportunities exist for them to be educated. And so I don't know. I'm hopeful that you know, there will be more opportunities in the future for women.
Thank you. And just like the United States and other countries where every school and every student is so different, the same thing definitely applies for Afghanistan. Let's take another round of questions from our students participating live. So let's start again with School of Education and Training. I'll go to Lynn Bloom and then Belmont. Thank you.
Omega. My name is Amir Lawson, and I wanted to ask Ms. Fung where she thinks the education and the economy in Afghanistan will be in the next decade or so. Thank you.
That's a really good question. I like to be hopeful. I really do. So I think that you are going to see, you know, as long as the economy can improve, you're going to see more people graduating from universities and getting jobs. So I see the country progressing over the next decade on their own, largely, once the international community starts pulling out. They still need our help right now in a lot of ways, but I think you're going to continue to see progress in that country. A lot of it depends on the security situation, unfortunately. And, you know, the Taliban are threatening, as they always do. We saw the last few weeks have been really hard and are by no means, you know, an indication of whether they can continue that into the future. I know that, you know, President Ghani is considering reconciliation with the Taliban, peace talks with them. Who knows where that might lead. And so I think, you know, I like to be hopeful. I don't, you know, people always ask, is Afghanistan going to turn into another Iraq? And I would like to say no. So I'm very hopeful for the future. But that's a really good question. Thank you.
Okay, go ahead, Lynn Bloom. Thank you.
My name is Makayla, and I go to Lynn Bloom, and I wanted to know what are young people respected in Afghanistan?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Are young people respected in Afghanistan, like young boys and girls?
Are young people respected? I think... Sorry, Ellie.
So I was actually going to jump in really quickly because we do have a wonderful young person from Afghanistan, our friend Nahida, who just joined us. So Nahida, can you please unmute, introduce yourself, share where in the world you are now and how you got there? And then also this question from our friends at Lynn Bloom High School. How are young people treated in Afghanistan? Thank you.
Okay. Hi, I'm Nahida Muradi, and I'm from Afghanistan. Now I'm in the United States in Oregon and studying at Oregon Episcopal School. I came here about 6 months ago, and as a young man in as a young woman in Afghanistan, I think I've survived. And I know it's media introduced my country a little like all the things are about war and the soldiers from the United States there. I mean, there are some other things that we value and we think about. I've gone to school there. It's still a little challenging there for other girls, young women, to go to school. But there are families beyond those girls who support their education and let them go to school. I mean, just see the changes that have happened since 2001, since Taliban have left. There were 0% of girls educated. And now there are more than 5 million girls who are educated and are still getting education. Every year, the number of people who are taking the exam of entering to universities increase, which is a good sign for all of the other people. We are actually getting more people to get an education and go to universities.
Thank you so much, Nahida, and thank you for joining us. We've been discussing a lot of these issues, and I believe that Belmont had a question too, so we're going to go ahead to Belmont to have them ask a question, either of you or Mellissa. And then, Nahida, if you have a question for your peers in the U.S., or Mellissa, our journalist guest speaker, you can go ahead. Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Lauren, and I'm just wondering, now in Afghanistan, you said you recently just came to the United States. I'm wondering, is there a difference in curriculum for girls and boys there? Like, are they required to take different classes or something like that? Thank you.
Should I go ahead and answer?
Sure, go ahead, Nahida. And then also we have some questions for our online audience that Mellissa maybe can answer, is how has the situation of women changed overall in Afghanistan since the Taliban fell?
Okay.
But Nahida, go ahead. Thanks.
Yes.
Yes.
So in Afghanistan, we have separate schools for boys and girls, but there are private schools who just we have mix of girls and boys in one school. We don't have different curriculums for both separately. It's just that there is a separation of gender, not a separation of good quality curriculum for boys or a good quality curriculum for girls. We both have the same curriculums, but it's just that we are separated and study in different places. And here in the United States, when I came, it was a big change for me studying with guys, but it wasn't that big because I have studied at Sola where we had boys, and then I have studied at private schools where I had boyfriends and guy friends who studied with me. So that it wasn't that big of a change. Thank you.
And I'll answer that second question about the overall progress that women have made. There has been a lot of progress. I think Nahida would agree with me on this last trip. You know, in this last election, 30% of members of parliament elected are women, which is, I think, it's more than the percentage of women MPs in Canada. We had a woman, Governor Sarobi, who was the governor of Bamiyan, run as a vice presidential candidate. So they've made huge progress, and the fact that, you know, things that were not talked about in the last 15 years or before the Taliban fell, like violence against women, which is still a huge problem, but it's now being talked about more openly. There are women's shelters in almost every province of the country where 12 years ago there was no such thing. So women do have a place to go and to talk about these things. There's been huge progress in terms of women's rights. The Elimination of Violence Against Women law was passed this last year, which outlaws things like BOD, which is the practice of trading women as a way to settle family disputes. That was outlawed. Child marriage was outlawed under this new EVA law. So there's been great progress. You know, you go into the provinces, again, that rural-urban divide, you still see things, you know, you still see some of these practices, but slowly, you know, women's rights have progressed so much in the last 12 years. And what I'm told, and I, you know, got to meet a lot of these great women, these advocates and activists on this last trip, they're concerned about what will happen once the international community leaves, whether, you know, the process of reconciliation with the Taliban might erode some of the progress they've made. I don't know, you know, Nahida, maybe you can chime in here, but but I see tremendous progress. And right now, I think women are just concerned about what might happen going forward. Thanks.
What she just said, that was all.
Thank you.
Okay, can I talk? Sorry. Okay. So just Mellissa said that we all I agree with what she said. I mean, there are women who are concerned about leaving the U.S. troops or all of the international troops who are in Afghanistan will leave. There are people who are concerned. But, you know, like, as a teenager, I just see all the positive things happening for my country in, like, 15 years or 20 years, we are going to have that change. And I'm being very optimistic about that change. So we just hope that we are going to continue just like this 12 years to improve and have the positive changes come in our country. But it's...
Hi, everyone. Sorry, we're experiencing some bandwidth problems. If we hold on just a moment... Hopefully it should catch up. Nahida, if you can hear me, you can continue your answer. And then if you have any questions for your peers in Massachusetts, Chicago, Illinois, or New Jersey, go ahead. Thank you.
Okay. So I was just, when it always comes to the U.S. troops being in Afghanistan and they're leaving from Afghanistan, it's kind of, I get emotional because they've been there for a long time now. And, I mean, I appreciate being there and helping our troops. But it always kind of bothers us that they all, for instance, bombing the houses and all of that. That's kind of humiliating our people. But then we think about, like, okay, for instance, when they have a statement to defend themselves, that's fine. But then we just should think about not only that side, but think about the other side of the issue, which there are people who are innocent and they're being killed. I mean, well, in some cases, yes, we need the U.S. troops there, but in some cases when, I just wonder that if the security pact is signed between the United States and Afghanistan, I just wonder the things that the U.S. troops couldn't do in 12 years that they have been there. Would they be able to do that in 5 years? That's a big question in my mind because I don't think that they would be able to do that in 5 years. But still, I am very thankful of the U.S. troops for being there, but also there are some... cases or some parts that I did not agree with what they did and what they always wanted to be independent in others' countries, which was kind of not okay. But yeah, I mean, I can understand what you all people, I mean, you all feel, because I talk against all those people who are from the United States. But just, I know that you guys are the bright side of this future. We all just are very, don't you just think that we are very optimistic about our future and we are the other generation of the future who are going to do much better job of helping and contributing to this world that we have in common. And I did not have any other questions, but I apologize for coming late, but I really enjoy talking to you guys. Thank you.
Thank you, Nahida. And I think that's a great note to transition on, that there's a lot of progress to make in Afghanistan, in the U.S., all around the world, in Canada, but it really is in your hands, in our hands. So let's spend the last 5 minutes of this conference talking to Lindblom School of Education Training in Belmont. How can you use education to improve your community? We talked before about how education is tied to jobs and unemployment, and maybe it also impacts different areas. So how can you use education to improve your own community? What can you learn from the lessons of Afghanistan? Let's start with Belmont, and then we will go to Lindblom and end with School of Education and Training. Thank you.
Maggie, and as a class, we talked about the importance of raising awareness in our community about different global issues surrounding education, especially in Afghanistan. And I think it's crucial for us to take what we learn in school and apply our global knowledge to our job and our life later, and take it to university, and even focus our education in college on something that we believe is important in education, whether that's becoming a teacher or learning about different cultures. And we're very grateful in our community to be able to have the opportunity to receive an education here that has a class like ours right now, which is global leadership, and be able to take that knowledge and go on to higher university. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sebring from Lindblom, and I think that we can use education to improve our community by taking it more seriously and letting others know about how taking it more seriously and making it more of a positive thing and making everybody want to partake in it. Thank you.
Big mouth.
Oh.
Go.
Okay. Hi. My name is Mel Hernandez, and one way that we believe that we can use education to better our community is because in our community we struggle with homelessness. There's a lot of people that are homeless, and you know, there's even kids that go to our school that don't have homes and live in homeless shelters. And as it's becoming winter, you know, it's hard for them. So we feel that, you know, for adults that are homeless, that the key to homelessness is because they didn't really get a good education, and it begins with illiteracy. And we feel like the kids in Chicago said, if we take education more seriously in our youth and better, you know, the education within us and others, and as far as our community, we can, you know, almost help and end homelessness and passion. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's exciting to hear so many ideas and the different kinds of ways that education can impact communities positively and negatively. We're at the end of our broadcast time. Unfortunately, we could keep going a whole nother hour. So I just want to say thank you to Mellissa, to Nahida, to all of our schools for participating, and our online viewers for the great questions. I know that this conversation isn't done, so if you have more questions, you can post them on the event page, and you can engage in other Pulse programs like this with Global Nomads Group and the Pulitzer Center for Crisis Reporting. And I hope that you continue to stay involved. In our last minute, I want to turn it back to Mellissa and Nahida if there's anything else you want to add or that you learned that you'd like to share. Start with Mellissa. Thank you.
My microphone is still. Oh, I was just going to say that this has been a great conversation, and I'm really, like Nahida, I'm very optimistic about what Afghanistan's future is going to be, and it's heartening to see that so many kids in this country are interested in what's happening there, and I think that, you know, the way to move forward, not just in Afghanistan, but as a global community, is for us to keep this dialogue going between students here and students there. I really do believe that Afghanistan has a great future. Nahida?
Thank you so much. I don't have much to say. I really, really appreciate your participating and being interested in this topic, because I know that the next generation, we are going to change the world. But there are, like, sometimes I think that there are some other fantasies that are going to happen in the future, like not only about good things are going to happen, but then there are people who can actually make other things happen. But yeah, I appreciate your being interested in this. And so one more thing that we talked about, women's issues, just last week I led a workshop, Asman, I led a workshop about women's, the He For She campaign and Girl Up and the International Day of the Girl since 2012 at World Affairs Council, where we had all students from high schools and in Oregon, and then so I was just wanted to ask you guys if you can raise awareness about those issues in your community, and just create clubs, and you can just raise awareness about what you can do as teenagers in your community for your community. Thank you.
Thank you. And Nahida, I'll share the link. You can post that information on our Google Plus event so your peers at Limbaum, SET, and Belmont can learn about it. And I hope that maybe you can have conversations that way. So thank you, everyone. This is another step in a lot of partnerships and exchanges. Like Mellissa said, we have much to learn from each other, and I hope to see you all soon. Please unmute your microphones and say goodbye or khadafiz. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.